have with us the first of our ET Selvam winners, Dr. Chirakshi Dhul. And Chirakshi is going to tell us in 7 minutes what her journey was to win the ET Selvam. So over to you, Chirakshi.
Thank you, sir. So I'll not waste the time and start with my presentation. Good evening, everyone. I am Chirakshi, and I am here to talk about my journey to ET Selvam Award 2020. The talk on which I got this award was Role of UBM in Planning Pediatric Cataract Surgery. First, the scientific segment of the presentation. We all know that pediatric cataract surgery is much more challenging compared to an adult surgery. UBM is a tool of qualitative and quantitative information for anterior segment of the eye. And decision of IOL implantation is always a little tricky in children and it needs further refining. Why do we want to implant IOL? Especially in a developing world like ours, I am talking only about the social problems and the outside problems, not surgical problems, not clinical problems, not glaucoma related problems. The aphakia as such, these big and heavy spectacles in a small child when the child is not even able to hold the neck is a huge difficulty. And just imagine for a unilateral cataract, see how thick the glass is. So when I did the review of literature, I found out that they have three parameters, axial length, corneal diameter, and age, which are used to calculate IOL power and to decide whether we are going to implant the IOL. So the idea was very simple. We had UBM and we were doing a lot of pediatric cataract surgery. I identified a gap in literature. We had no normogram for average sulcus size and bag size. And the correlation of these factors with white to white and visual length and age was not available. So on this, we devised a study to know the role of UBM in planning pediatric cataract surgery. I recruited 353 consecutive eyes of 197 patients with congenital or developmental cataract, excluding traumatic and other etiologies. A detailed examination under anesthesia was done. We arrived at the results after refining our methodology and conducting the study for 3 years. These were the parameters which we looked at, and we divided the study into 4 groups, 0 to 6 months, 6 months to 2 years, 2 years to 5 years, and 5 to 10 years. And we gave a normogram for axial length, white to white, angle to angle, sulcus to sulcus. In addition, we gave a normogram to new parameters, bag diameter and lens thickness. This was the qualitative part of the study in which we looked at the morphology, most common being zonular, but anterior capsular plaques, posterior plaques, membranous cataract were also not that rare. With UBM, we had no surgical surprises, 0% missed morphology. When we studied the correlation among parameters, we found that bag diameter, where we are actually going to implant the IOL, has a poor correlation with age and white to white, and a very weak correlation. Very weak correlation with anterior chamber depth, angle to angle, and sulcus to sulcus. So with that in our mind, we came at the conclusion that UBM is an effective tool in diagnosing missed morphology, unique morphologies, which are otherwise missed by a clinical examination. Size of capsular bag is not directly related to the white to white of the patient. And bag diameter is a new novel parameter which is useful in planning in the bag cataract surgery for children. Shifting to a little bit about the challenges faced, I would say that despite being in a premium institution, I am actually lucky. We had all the help we could get. We had so many residents helping around. We had all the equipment available with us. and the number of patients coming to us. So at RT Center, the LEMS clinic is the largest clinic running in Asia of pediatric cataract that has been published in JPOS. But despite that, I think there are two big issues which I faced. One was time management. At the end of my junior residency, I realized that I had not even published a single paper. An MD from AIIMS and not even one paper is a little difficult thing. In my senior residency, I decided that from the beginning, I'm going to have a dedicated time for research. Even after coming home at 12 o'clock, you have to have at least 1 hour of dedicated time for research. Then only you can do something about it. The second point which I had a doubt as an MD student, I used to feel that clinical and surgical part is more important than academic. I used to read textbooks, but the research part of academic was a little tricky. What I realized over the course of years was that a lot of good academicians are good clinicians and surgeons. So it's not a battle between the two. A lot of them are very good clinicians as well, although the vice versa may not be true, but that is something we need to think about. So there's one question which residents have in their mind, like, why should you present at conferences? You can just attend them. Personally, I feel that to have a positive and active involvement in the conference, you need to present something. Then only you are going to put effort from your side. Once you put an effort from your side, you are more involved in the conference, you are more interested in learning. The constructive criticism helps a lot. So for example, I presented a paper somewhere and somebody had pointed out a very big flaw. Later on, we could easily publish that study by just correcting that little flaw in my presentation. The exposure which a conference provides is a great thing, especially for a shy person like me. So it does help you get out there and talk to people. It boosts your confidence, and whether you win or not, it's a win-win situation. After a while, let's talk a little about what to present. Before going to the actual pointers, I would like to show a definition. What is evidence-based medicine? It's a conscientious, explicit, judicious, and reasonable use of modern best evidence in making decisions about patient care. This term was invented by Guyatt in 1991, 30 years back for the first time. In the last 30 years, the meaning of evidence-based medicine has changed a lot, at least in the clinical practice. So what we are expected now is to know the level of evidence. The background information and expert opinion is the lowest level of evidence we have in our literature. The highest level being systematic reviews and meta-analysis, followed by RCTs and quasi-experimental studies and observational studies. So instead of giving importance to what you have developed over the years as a clinician, now is the time to give importance to what is happening outside in the world. Stay updated. Know that new things are happening every day, especially in the COVID time. I think this mindset has changed because we know a new disease came, new treatment options came, and we have still been able to manage or control the disease. So medicine is changing so fast. The traditional concept of background textbook information is now not valid anymore. Hence my point that it's not a competition between a clinician / surgeon with academics. It has to go on together. Then I think we can answer this question now, that what do you want to present at a conference? It has to be a well-designed study. If the design is flawed, then you're not going to come out with a good or a significant outcome. It has to be clinically relevant, and staying updated to the literature helps you identify the gap in the existing literature, and then you can probably add something to it. The question of how to present a poster. A poster presentation is very different from a paper presentation. In paper, you have a dais, you have an audience. People get to ask you questions and you need to tell them your story in your own words. A poster is something somebody is going to look at and decide. So I would say make a checklist of all the headings. Whatever things you want to put in your poster, make a checklist priority-wise. Use a lot of figures and graphs. Highlight methodology and results. Introduction and discussion does not have much role in a physical poster presentation because You do not want overcrowding to happen. You want somebody who knows nothing about the topic to read the poster, walk away with at least some information about how you did it and what you did in your study. And you should seek professional help. Like at least for first few posters, ask somebody who makes those kind of posters in department. In AIMS, we had a female department, but even if you don't have, many, many people, computer people are doing that, and it's fairly easy. After a couple of posters, you know how to make them. It's not that difficult. What works? Actually, I should put it like what worked for me. I think staying updated, it always works and it has to continue. Second thing I would say, like you should seek mentorship. Even if you don't have a mentor, you can actually seek a mentor. Mentorship has done wonders for me. I am 30 and I am releasing my third book next week. So it does work, and it is not possible without all the help you can get. So you may not get help on your own, but ask for help. People help you. Everybody is there, especially in institutions. You have so many people. We have a compilation. We had a compilation of 150 residents in RCC. So nobody can do everything alone. You ask for help and you'll get it. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rakshi. Fantastic. The science came up. Also, your ambition came up. Your heart came out. Wonderful. So we'll have now Dr. Subhangi Bhave and Dr. Parikshit discuss your topic.
Bhave ma'am, would you go first or I should?
Yeah, you go first.
Okay. No, this was fantastic. Presentation, of course, it's a huge series of pediatric cataracts, and yes, you are, as you proudly said, it's one of the busiest clinics in the world, and I'm sure you must be following it up, because you have shown how UBM really can help in seeing what the back size is. The biggest challenge in pediatric cataract surgery is placing the lens in the back. So I'm sure you must be having another series ready of the post-op ones to see which were in the bag and which were not. And correlating the outcomes of pediatric cataract surgery, because we know they are not as good as adult cataract surgery. And there are many factors, amblyopia being, of course, the most important one, the delay between having the cataract and getting the surgery done, and of course, comorbidities, if any. But then, yes, as many of us surgeons, very, you know, proud of their surgical skills, one of the most important thing is to have the lens properly placed in the bag. So perhaps I'm sure we will see a new series from you correlating the outcomes of cataract surgery versus the placement in the bag in UBM. So we really look forward to that and to see if that there is any change in the placement over the years, because as the child's eye grows and develops, the refractive error changes and perhaps the effective lens position also changes. So that has not been studied. So we look forward to studying that from you. But otherwise, as Dr. Yes, Partha said, awesome.
Thank you, sir. And as you rightly pointed out, there has been a second study devised on the first study normogram. What we want to find out from the second study is that we want to give a cutoff for bag diameter. In this diameter onwards, it is safe to put an IOL without encountering glaucoma or pigment dispersion. Similarly, for sulcus to sulcus also, we want to give a cutoff. Today, right now, we are using indirect markers such as age. Age of the child, axial length of the child, white to white of the child. We should be using direct evidence, because we are going to implant the IOL either in the bag or in the sulcus. We should look at those parameters to finalize the outcome. This way we can optimize a surgery which has been, obviously it is developing over the last 20 years very well, but this is something which can change the paradigm in the surgery in the future.
It was a great presentation, Chirakshi. I just wanted to ask you one thing, ki what additional information, as you have said that we have got all these, the back-to-back, the sulcus size, to say that we can implant the lens into the bag, which is more so more important even for a unilateral cataract, especially in a child. So as of now, what is your cutoff size in a unilateral cataract for IOL implantation?
So based on the normogram for the age, we know that for bag diameter, ma'am, the average size is around 9, and not, we know from the anatomy studies, from 6 to 9, it happens in the anatomy of the eye. The lens develops over the time. Although the IOL throughout length is around 13 millimeters or 12.5 millimeters in most of the IOLs, they are foldable IOLs. They are not rigid IOLs. The haptics easily mold inside the bag. So when the lens is normal, the lens thickness and the bag diameter is normal, we always implant an IOL. For bilateral cataract, till now, we have been using the cutoff of 10 as wide to wide. For bag diameter, we are using a cutoff of 8. For unilateral cataract, the cutoff is 0.5 millimeter less. So even if it is a little tighter, we are preferring using an IOL. So in eyes with 9.5 wide to wide, bag diameter of 7.5 also, we are implanting IOL. The only problem in those cases are unilateral eyes are as such not normalized. So unilateral eyes, I believe that almost all unilateral eyes, with some exceptions of congenital cataracts, have a component of PSP, PCD, PC plaque. They have developmental anomalies within the eyes. So their angle structures are also not normal. They have higher risk of glaucoma. For those eyes, when the bag is really small, or the eye size is really small, it's a little tricky to implant an IOL.
Yes.
Till now, we are using the cutoff of 9.5. Let's see if we can refine that even further. We can pick and choose those eyes where we can and cannot do it.
If the lens is completely mature in a child, can you still see a posterior capsular defect with the help of UVM?
Yes, ma'am, very clearly. In fact, that's a very good question. I'll just show one slide. So just look at image E and F. It's a total cataract. We can't make out that there's a PCD, but look here. So the posterior capsule is visible till here, and then all the lens matter is in the vitreous cavity, anterior vitreous cavity, and then it starts again. So we know that there's a large PCD. There's not going to be a surprise on table. We can devise the surgical technique before proceeding inside. We would normally use a cutter.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And
wonderful,
the
wonderful.
Youngest child you would operate a unilateral and put a lens?
Yes, this patient has a normal bag size, and we put implant in IOL. It depends. So we have given, in our book, we have given a classification of PCB, which is of three types. Type one is a PCB, which is a spindle-shaped PCB, large in size, and sometimes the margins extend. So then you may have also encountered it in your practice, that sometimes you see that there's a clear margin spindle-shaped PCB. In these cases, if the size is more than 5 millimeters, we implant an IOL in the sulcus and we capture. In the second type, there is a fibrosed margin of the posterior capsule. So in those cases, generally the PCD is smaller than 5 millimeters. In those cases, we implant the IOL in the bag and we leave the PC as such. The PC defect acts as a PCC in those cases. And in the bag, implantation is easy, it is stable, the IOL doesn't move. The third type is the one which is associated with PC plaque. And in those, you know, you have to do plaque for X-rays or some peeling of the plaque and then decide how to proceed.
So, Partha, can I ask Chirakshi something? Though I'm not supposed to be commenting.
No, you are supposed to be commenting. You can ask, but okay. A quick question because...
One quick question, Chirakshi. I'm not going to ask you anything academic because I think Partha said that this is an ET Selvam. And we have to give a message to people who may be watching this. So when you decided to present this as a poster, did you submit it as a poster oblique paper or just you submit it purely as a poster?
Physical poster only.
So that means you were aiming for ET Selvam in the beginning?
Not really. I would not say that. But I thought that this will make a very interesting poster rather than paper. It would have made a good paper as well. And I have presented this paper at American Academy. But I thought that this time I want to present it like a physical poster because it has all the right aesthetics for a poster.
There are some more questions. I think we'll carry on with the next presentation.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much, Chirakshi.
Partha, you need to keep a watch on time as well.
Yes. Sunilji, you're the timekeeper.
25, 30 minutes for one discussion.
right. So, Chirakshi, last and final question. Who is your mentor? A very obvious question.
Dr. Khokesh.
So, thank you. Thank you very much, Chirakshi.